Great you're with us today, and we'd like to welcome you if it's your first time with us. So welcome in the name of Jesus. And it says this in the Psalms. It says this in Psalm 139. It says this in 139. It says, O Lord, you have searched me and you have known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You understand my thoughts far off. You comprehend my path and my lying down. You comprehend my path and my lying down. We just praise the Lord. We bless the Lord. And we just praise him because he knows everything about us. He knows every hair on our head. He knows what we're going to do before we do it. That's amazing, isn't it? That's amazing. And Psalm 138 says this, and this is what we're going to do. I will praise you with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing praises to you. I will worship towards your holy temple and praise your name and your loving kindness and your truth, for you have magnified your word above all your name. Your word above. What we're going to do, we're going to celebrate this morning, we're going to sing some songs, and we're going to worship Jesus. Amen.
This morning we're all standing, so yes, let's worship again.
Thank you. 'Twas grace that's all my heart. Lord, we thank you that you can come so freely and openly to worship you, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Almighty God, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Lord, we thank you for your words to us. Lord, we thank you for your promises that they are yes and amen.
Yes, they are.
Lord, we continue to cry out for this area of Sebastopol. We say, Lord, we ask for a mighty move upon this nation, upon this community, Lord,
yes.
Upon Wales. That, Lord, a mighty, mighty move, Lord, that would see people's lives changed for you, Lord Jesus. That, Lord, that they could know it was you that's calling them by name. Oh, Father God, you created us all in your sight, Lord, and you love each and every one. Lord, that you do not want any to perish, and we claim it for this area. We claim it, Lord, for Wales and beyond. Oh, Lord God, we thank you for who you are. Lord, we thank you for what you've done for us. That, Lord, you have saved us and you've redeemed us. Father God, we praise you, Almighty God.
Yes.
And, Lord, as we continue to pray for those who are in need of a healing touch, Lord,
yes,
we continue to pray for Carol,
yes,
for Danny, healing in the mighty name of
yes,
Jesus. By your stripes we are healed.
Yeah.
Lord, we claim it, and we receive it in your precious name, Lord Jesus. And Lord, as we come to hear your word to us this morning, Lord, I pray that you would just continue to still our hearts and our minds, that Lord, whatever's gone on this morning, whatever's gone on this week, that Lord, we just leave it at your feet, so that we are open and empty to receive all that you want us to receive, Lord Jesus. Because, Lord, it's not about us, it's about you. So, Lord, we say, have your way. Have your way, Lord Jesus, in this place. Have your way in us. Father God, we thank you. And I bless you and praise you in your mighty name, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you,
Kathy.
Thank you, Sharon. Awesome. I want to be obedient to God with this, be obedient to our Lord and Saviour. A word came to me as I was worshipping them, and I believe this is for somebody either here today or somebody listening today, and it's simply this: Jehovah Jireh, the Lord is your provider. Somebody needs to hear that today, and I'm just going to say that. It's quite a simple word, but it means a lot. Jehovah Jireh. The Lord is your provider. The Lord is your provider indeed. So with that, may I just say a few notices before we begin. Yes, prayer group is back in the church, and that is on Tuesday, 7 o'clock. And life studies are back on Thursday, and that's at 7 o'clock. So that's on Thursday. So if you can attend, come along. It's great to pray as a community. We need prayer. The community need prayer. The country needs prayer. We need prayer. Yeah, prayer is a powerhouse of the church. Spurgeon said that. It's a powerhouse of the church. So if you can support it, please do. Then on Thursday, there is life groups, and we're going to be studying the book of Acts. We're going to be studying the book of Acts, which I think is a great way to start just after Easter. Yes, great way to start just after Easter. So let's look into the Word of God. And I want to continue on the path of the resurrection. See, this is an important part of the church, of who we are, what we believe. And why? Because the truth is Christianity rests heavily on this. But as it unfolds, you will see it is connected. But today's title is, Don't Let the Whelk Suck the Life of You. Don't let the whelk suck the life of you. If you know what a whelk is, it's a little sea creature. Yeah? More on that as I speak. But that is the title for today's word. Don't let the whelk suck the life out of you. So we go to John 20, 24 to 30. And I've taken it from the English Standard Version. And it's a story most of us know. It's about Jesus and Thomas. And it says in this version, "Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, 'We've seen the Lord.' But he said to them, 'Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails and place my fingers into the mark of the nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe.' 8 days later, the disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them this time. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you.' Then he said to Thomas, 'Put your finger here and see my hands. Put your finger here, sorry, it's inside. And see my hands. Yeah? And put up your hand and place it on in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe.' Thomas answered him, 'My Lord and my God.' Jesus said to him, 'Have you believed because you have seen me?' And he goes on to say, 'Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed.'" Wow, what a story that is. We've all heard that story, perhaps. You know, it's a well-known story. But do you know what? I do feel a little sorry for Thomas at this point. Yeah? I do feel a little sorry for Thomas being known as the famous doubter. You know, we look at him for the negative, the doubter. And isn't that true today? You know, we can do loads of good, and we can be loads of good, and yet people pick up on that negativity. But let's go on. He was the most famous doubter in the Bible because he was so much more than his doubts. Doubting Thomas was also a believing Thomas. He was a man of faith. But how could he doubt, you say? Well, let me ask you a question. Have you ever had a doubt? Have you ever had a doubt? A doubt about anything? Have you had a doubt? Think about it. He was not with the others at the time the others saw Jesus. He was not there who came to say they had seen being with Jesus. How could this be? It's going on in his head. Not even the 10 disciples. How could they have seen Jesus? See, we look at this as a complete picture. We look at this and we see the complete picture. Thomas is not looking at this and seeing the complete picture here. But for Thomas, well, let's take a look at Thomas. I want to tell you a bit about Thomas first. Thomas is only mentioned of one in 12 in Matthew and Luke. He is listed as one of the ones that was given a special title, that of an apostle. In John 11:16, we learn that he was called Didymus, which means twin, but doesn't tell us who his twin was. We don't know who his twin was. A verse that gives us a great insight of Thomas personally is found in the same chapter of John, near the end of the ministry in John 11:1-3. I know there's a lot of verses, you can look at them after. Jewish leaders were plotting to kill him. Then Thomas, also known as Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, "Let us go, and we may die with him." Being extremely loyal in John 14:1-6, when Jesus told his disciples that he was going to leave them very soon to go to his Father's house to prepare a place for them, this confused the disciples. And Thomas was the first to speak up and say, "Lord, we don't know where we're going, so how can we know the way?" This statement implies that Thomas wanted to figure it out and wanted desperately to go where his rabbi was going. And in John 11, 16, this verse gives great insight into Thomas's personality and his family and saying, see, I believe Thomas can't wrap his head around this situation. He can't wrap his head around this situation. Thus he declares that until he sees and touches Jesus, he will never believe. It is because of this strong statement that Thomas has been labelled the doubting Thomas. The question is, was his requirement reasonable or was it unreasonable? Now, I'm not saying it was right or wrong. We could all say from a psychological standpoint, it's natural for people to doubt extraordinary claims, especially if they contradict their prior beliefs or experiences. Thomas' request to see physical evidence could be seen as a way to reconcile his doubt and confirm the reality in his situation. May I say, could has been. Because Matthew Henry gives us another point of this, and I want to take you down this. See, he did not pray, Matthew Henry says, in just difference to the testimony of his fellow disciples, who were men of wisdom, integrity, and ought to have been credited. He knew them to be honest men. All 10 of them occurred in his testimony with great assurance. And yet he could not persuade himself to say that the record was true. Christ had chosen them to be witnesses of his very thing to all nations. And yet Thomas, one of his own community, would not allow them to be complete witnesses, nor trust them further than he could see them. It was not, however, the curiosity that he questioned, but their prudence. He feared they were too creditless. So let's look at this and break it down a little bit. We've seen the positive things, you know, the things that Thomas has done, yeah? And we see that Thomas is known for his doubting, yeah? But we know it with the doubting Thomas. When you do things, you know, perhaps you're doing something and somebody will say to you, have some faith, are you a doubting Thomas? You know, how many times have you heard that? We hear that, yeah? But let's look at the details and break it down. Fellow disciples as men of wisdom and integrity. See, the other disciples were regarded as wise and honest individuals whose testimony should have been trusted. The fellow disciples as men of wisdom and integrity. The other disciples were regarded as wise, honest individuals. Yeah. Knowing them to be honest, Thomas was aware of the honesty and integrity of his fellow disciples. A lot of honesty and integrity going on, yeah? Yeah? All 10 of them, excluding Thomas and Judas Iscariot, gave their testimony with confidence. Yet Thomas distrusted dispute assurances. He distrusted. Despite the confidence and the agreement among the other disciples, Thomas still couldn't bring himself to believe that testimony. He couldn't believe it. It was Christ's choice of witness to show himself to the disciples. If you look back in the verses prior to this, you will see that Jesus came in a room which was locked and appeared to the other disciples. They were just surely relaying what they had seen to Thomas. Thomas lacked trust in their competency. In other words, Thomas doubted whether his final is fellow, I'm not functioning well today, please excuse me. Thomas, doubted whether his fellow disciples were competent witnesses. He couldn't bring himself to trust them beyond what he could personally see. There's people like that today, you know? They can't bring themselves to trust them beyond what they can personally see. We see that in people today, don't we? He was questioning prudence, not veracity. Thomas' skeptic wasn't about whether the other disciples were truthfully, but rather whether they were prudent or wise in their judgment. He feared they might have been too quick to believe with the sufficient evidence. We could say Thomas, he had it about with a doubt. But he did have a bout with a doubt. Yeah? And what do you know with your doubt? And we all, if we're honest, sometimes doubt something or someone. But do you know it can be a difference between helping you and hindering your Christian growth? I want to tell you that again. It can be the difference between helping and hindering your Christian growth. If you use your doubt to spur yourself on knowing God better than you will know God better, as you hold on to what you know is true, despite your doubts, your faith will hold its ground. Our faith holds its ground, yeah? And that should have held Thomas's ground. Jesus knew how fear would shake his disciples' hearts, and it wouldn't be easy for them to believe. See, in John 14:1-27, tells us he told them not to let their hearts be troubled or afraid. Don't even be scared of your own doubts. The risen Christ conquers all. You know, Christian author Dallas Willard said, "We live in a culture that has for centuries now cultivated the idea that the skeptical person is always smarter than the one who believes. You can almost be as stupid as a cabbage as long as you doubt." See, doubt also shouldn't be a stigma in the church. It should not be a stigma in the church. People ask for prayer for almost anything else in the church, but really for doubt. Really they come and say, "Can you pray for my doubt?" Yet our pews are full of closet doubters because we fear our doubt. It's frightening, isn't it? Instead, it needs to be a talking point. And a tipping point leads us through the desperation closer to God. Let your doubt bring you closer to God. Doubt in life feels like swimming in an alligator-infested swamp. Have you ever been in an alligator-infested swamp? I've not been there. I don't know what it's like. But I'm told doubt in life feels like swimming in an alligator-infested swamp. They can be scary and swallow us up if we dwell or swim in them rather than take them to Jesus. Doubt can swallow you up if you don't take it to Jesus. He becomes a bridge of safety, helping us walk over and above our doubts. So John took his doubts straight to Jesus, as Thomas did too. We're almost susceptible to doubt when the world weighs heavy on us. When the world weighs heavy on you, that is a time doubt creeps in. Things weren't turning out for John the Baptist as he expected. However, even in his doubt, Jesus described John the Baptist as the greatest man born of woman. Jesus offers us a secret of why we doubt. And that secret is because we are human and made of dust. We need to be honest about our doubts. In Matthew 28, 17, we see other disciples. Thomas wasn't the only disciple that doubted. We see other disciples doubting the resurrection of Christ. And who he was, he claimed to be. However, Thomas was the honest one. Now the 11, and if you want to read that, that's in Matthew 28, 17. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to a mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. See, Mark 9 tells the story of the father bringing his son to Jesus. The boy struggled with seizures and asked Jesus, "But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us." That's what the father said. He said, "If you can do anything, you know, but if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us." Jesus replies this, "If you can, everything is possible for him who believes." Immediately the boy's father exclaimed, I do believe, but help me overcome my unbelief." Wow, that's doubt, isn't it? Help me overcome my doubt, my unbelief. Perhaps you can relate to this in some way or the other. Perhaps you've been in a situation and you're going through a situation. Perhaps you've been in and thought, and doubts crept in. Because the enemy does that sort of thing. Don't forget, we are most susceptible to doubt when the world weighs heavy on us. And anybody heard of the man called Wesley? Yeah? Wesley, a great man, conversion at Aldersgate, when he wrote of his heart being strangely warmed. It was May the 24th, 1738. I was very small then. No, I wasn't even a twinkle in my parents. I mean, they way down the line somewhere it was. We assume that he lived happily ever after, don't we? We think Wesley, you know, he's a great man of God, isn't he? He's done great things. You know, he's a founder of some churches. We assume he lived happily ever after from that point. But less than a year later, Wesley wrote in his journal this: "I know that I am not a Christian. I know it because I do not feel that I love God and his son Jesus Christ as my Saviour." Later, he led England in the great spiritual awakening that sparked the revival in America. Wow, what a man of God. Yet, doubt crept in. He had doubt, and he wrote it for us to see. But look what he achieved with God. Look what God had done through him. Look what God done through him. You know, led in England a great spiritual awakening. God used him. Yeah? See, we ask God to set your experience of doubt apart for his glory. See, the enemy would like to take your doubts. The enemy would like to tap you on the shoulder with your doubt and destroy you. That's what happens The enemy grabs hold of it, doesn't he? Something, what we're going through. And we're praying hard for this situation. And we don't see it moving, or we don't see it from God's, what God sees. And doubt creeps in. And the enemy grabs hold of it. Yeah? Because he's good at doing things like that, isn't he? He grabs hold of it and blows it up even further. He wants to destroy you. However, you can commission your doubt about his service of God. Doubt, like suffering, is a tool God can use if only we turn it over to him. This is important. We need to turn over our doubts to God. We need to do that. So what happened as the script? We're talking about Thomas here. So why have you suddenly gone off Thomas? Well, I think there's some good points to be out on this. 8 days later, his disciples were inside again. And Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said this. I'm telling you all. No, he didn't say that. He said this. Peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands. And put out your hands and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. If we only get that today, if we only get that at this sermon today, this word of God, if we only get them words, you know, do not disbelieve, but believe. It will improve your life. I guarantee. True, Thomas is lovingly reprimanded by Christ. But he does it in a loving way, doesn't he? Yeah? He doesn't scorn Thomas. He does it in a loving way. The episode is recorded in the Gospel as an encouragement to generations of believers who will come after and will not have the benefit of Thomas' first-hand experience. And Jesus says this to Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed, and this is for us today. This is for us today. Blessed are those you have not seen and yet have believed. Amen. Amen. What a great encouragement for us today in the church. Yeah? As we reflect on these profound words spoken by Jesus and Thomas, inviting him to touch his wounds and believe, let us also consider the invitation extended to each one of us. Just as Thomas was urged to move from doubt to faith, we are too encouraged to approach the Saviour with our doubts and uncertainties, trusting that he will meet us with compassion and understanding. Let us respond to his call to believe, to place our faith in him, and to experience a transformation that comes from encountering his love and grace. So what about the whelk? What did I say about the whelk? Do anybody remember the title of the whelk? It says, don't let the whelk suck the life out from you. Well, the whelk is this little ocean creature, and it can ruin an oyster's day. The whelk has an appendage that works like a corkscrew, with which it can bore a small hole in the top of an oyster's shell. Then through this very small hole, a whelk can devour an entire oyster. It simply sucks it out little by little until the oyster is gone. And do you know what? A little doubt can do this to a person as well.
So strong and so mighty, there's nothing my God can undo.
go before us, but go with us and remain with us always. Bless and protect each and every one here this morning in your precious name, Jesus. Amen.
So we have a special birthday this week. Mike, I believe it might be your birthday tomorrow.
Your birthday tomorrow, Mike?
No problem.
We've been told we got connections.
Yeah, we got to see.
We asked him. I told us how old you are, but I don't have
it. I think the video might.
Are you in 5 from 18?
What?
What?
Okay.
So yeah, say happy birthday to mine.
Let's say happy birthday to mine.
Happy birthday to you.